How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself? He offered himself without spot to God. Cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. So when you look up to the cross, you will think how to live this life of crucifixion, to offer your life as a sacrifice. Also given in the book of Corinthians, that for indeed Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us. So the term sacrifice was given for the Lord, and then, you know, we are all requested to live this life of sacrifice. In order to, you know, memorize the idea, to keep the idea in our mind, we will put the sacrifice meanings in the letters S, A, C, and, you know, for the S, in order to start offering your life to God as a sacrifice, you need to see others' needs. You need to see with Christ's eyes. Christ can see people differently, because, you know, we may focus on the bad things in the people around. But when Christ looked to anyone, he could see his needs. We see him with a loving eye. So, you know, in the theology of the Orthodoxy, the Church is not busy with her member. Actually, the Orthodox Church is always busy with the whole world. We are responsible for everyone in the world. That's the theology of the Church, because the Church is the heart of Christ, and Christ came to save everyone. So the Church is busy with everyone. So can you see people with Christ's eyes? Can you see their needs? Can you see the poor in this world? Can you see the sick people? Can you see the forgotten people? Can you see the orphans? Or you don't see all these people? In order to offer your life as a sacrifice, you need to change in your eyes. You have to have these glasses of the Lord to see differently, to see others' needs. So the Church is responsible, in a way, for the pains and the sufferings of the whole world. And we need to go out of our comfort zone in order to offer our life as a sacrifice. We need to share what we have. We need to see their needs and to think of what they need. It was written in the Bible, Christ, though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, because he was focusing on our needs, not on his glory. So because of us, he came, and he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. So S simply stands for try to see others' needs. The A, act always lovingly, act always in love. In order to live, to offer your life as a sacrifice, you know the commandment of loving each one, everyone, to love people, to love your neighbor as you love yourself. And written by St. Paul, let all that you do be done with love. Whatever you do, just act in love. Do it in love. You smile to all faces, you respect everyone, you help everyone, and you know, remind yourself always that love never fails. By love you can win many souls to God. By love you can proclaim the new, you know, the good news of the Bible. By love you can change the hearts of people. By love you can live a better life, and also let others live this better life. As written and given by the Lord himself, I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. So all these acts, love, bless, do good, and pray, you know, these all acts of love, actions of love, attitudes of love, So in order to offer your life as a sacrifice, you need to see others' need, and you need to be ready to act always lovingly. Whatever you do, do it in a loving way. The sea of sacrifice, care not for yourself. For anyone who focuses on himself, he cannot offer himself as a sacrifice. Most of the people are busy with what they want, what they need, what they like, what they look like. But in order to offer your life as a sacrifice, you shouldn't care for your life. Care not for yourself. Just forget about yourself. Deny yourself. Ignore what you want to do. Focus more on what God wants you to do. Focus more on what people need for their salvation. If you do this, now you can live this new life of offering yourself as a sacrifice. Don't focus on your rest, pleasure, money, benefit, glory. As given by St. Paul, one of the very good models in this, he was telling the priest in his famous sermon given in the book of Acts, none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself. I don't count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy in the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. For this man could give his life as a sacrifice to save many thousands of people of the pagans at that time, because he could not, deny himself. He cared not for himself. So the S stands for see others' needs, the A, act always lovingly, and the C, care not for yourself. The R, realign the values. In order to offer yourself as a sacrifice, you need to value things differently, because most of the people nowadays, they value money, they value pleasure, they value titles. But in Christian worldview, we value people, we value souls. We respect human beings much more than we respect any materialistic things. So you need to remind yourself, to remember that the value of a man, whatever he looks like, a child or an old man, ignorant, retarded, but he is a man, he is God's image. So we respect him much more than millions of dollars. So in order to offer your life as a sacrifice, you need to, examine your values. Do you see the values as given by God or as given by the world nowadays? Because people speak about different values than the Bible values. So we have to realign the real values. Man is much more important than any money. But the world say the opposite. Money is much more important than thousands of people. So they are making money on, regardless whatever happening to the people. Also, you value the toil, the value of labor, because now pleasure is a target in life. But for Christian, we are not targeting to enjoy this life. This life will end soon, but we want to catch the kingdom of heaven. So we value the labor in order to get the kingdom of heaven. We understand this value, that nowadays it's the time to do effort, to labor for our salvation and others' salvation. So if you have this value, you are busy serving people. You are happy to travel here and there to serve people. You don't, save your effort, but you are happy offering you whatever you have in order to save others. Also, you value the time, because many of the young people never consider the importance of time, days, weeks, months, years. But actually, if you understand your goal in life and you are sharing the Lord Himself in building up the kingdom of heaven, You are responsible to save many souls. Now you will value the time. You are not going to just waste your time anyway. So the S stands for you have to see others' needs. A, act always in love. C, care not for yourself. R, realize the real value, the Christian values, as given by the Lord Himself. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? What will a man give in exchange for his soul? So that's kind of valuing things. Do you value your life more than you value materials or money? The eye of sacrifice imitate Christ. Because basically Christ is the sacrifice. He sacrificed his life for us. He offered his life to save everyone. And now we are following him. We should imitate him. Because he lived the life of sacrifice. Before even he was crucified, he lived the whole life with the attitude of sacrifice. He sacrificed everything just to save us. So by imitating Christ, now we can offer our life as sacrifice. He said it this way, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. So because he lived the life of a servant, all Christians should be servants. All Christians should live the life of serving others, because our God served us, came to serve everyone. Again, he said it this way, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. So the eye of sacrifice is to imitate Christ himself. The F of sacrifice, forget what's behind. Many people, when they look back, they feel bad that they lost many things. They are not happy with whatever happened to them or whatever they have done to themselves. But when you focus on the past, you never move forward. In order to have a mission in life, in order to offer your life as a sacrifice, you shouldn't forget, you should forget what's behind. Don't look back. As always said by St. Paul, brother, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. Because, you know, for example, if he looked back and he focused on his past, you know, he was a persecutor of the church. He was a blasphemer. He was a very bad guy. So if he kept himself imprisoned in the past, and he had this guilt feeling, he would never move on to serve God. But he could forget the past. He passed it. And he focused on the future. By doing this, he could offer his life as a sacrifice. And he had a great mission in life. Because he never focused on the past. Or we all have bad things in our past. Bad things we have done or others have done with us. But all this shouldn't, you know, take part of our mind. Try to forget the hurts caused by people, and also try to forget the rejection or injustice happened in your family or with your friends. You have a mission. So you please focus on the future. Don't look back. Joseph of the Old Testament had this experience because his brothers hurt him a lot. If he focused on how much hurt he had, he would have never done what he had done. Because, you know, he had a mission in life. That's why one day he said it this way, as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring it about as it is this day, to save many people alive. So he could understand the will of God. He never focused on what they had done with him. He focused on what God wants him to do. So he did not look back to cry, you know, upon the hurt he had from his brothers. So he forgave them because he had a greater mission in life to save millions of people in his generation. So the F is about forget what's behind. That's why Jesus said, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. In order to move forward, you need to forget what's behind. The eye of sacrifice, the second eye, involve others in your life, integrate them. Because you know, you have many good things in your life. You have some talents, you have some knowledge, you have some money, you have your mind. Many other people does not have any of these. So why don't you just share this with them? Help them to enjoy what you have. When you travel Africa or you come to Sa'id in our land, Egypt, you know, you will help pleasing others by what you have. And by doing this, you are offering partially your life as a sacrifice. Try not to enjoy your life alone. You can never actually enjoy life with no one around. But you will enjoy life more and more when you plead others, when you deliver this joy to people, you can feel more happy. And given in the Bible, do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing some have unwillingly entertained angels. Remember the prisoner, as if chained with them, those who are mistreated, since you yourself are in the body also. So you know, you share the feeling. You put yourself in their shoes, in their position. You imagine yourself in their pains and suffering. So you want them to enjoy what you have, and you put them in their place. That's kind of offering your life and the sacrifice. The C, cut off your old nature. In order to imitate Christ and to live this life of sacrifice, you need to cut off the old nature. I mean, you need to stop your lust, you stop being busy with pleasures of this world, you try to stop sinning, because this sinful life can never help you to offer your life as a holy sacrifice. So you need to struggle, to strive to be pure. As given in the Bible, therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth. It's not the hands and the legs, you know. Put to death fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. And also in the same chapter, he mentioned other sins like, now you yourself are to put off all these anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. So when you clean your heart, when you have this pure life, when you live a new Christian life, when you cut off the old nature, the sinful life, you can have this sacrificial life. The last letter is to enjoy working with the Holy Spirit. E stands for enjoying working with the Holy Spirit. You all, like altars of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwelt in your heart. And the Holy Spirit wants all of you to be saints, to share God the kingdom of heaven, to save many souls. So you will work together with the Spirit of God himself. So you will enjoy this sharing, you know, the partnership, the fellowship with God himself to save others. That's the idea, how to offer yourself as a sacrifice. That's why the Lord said, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. So the Holy Spirit will remind you with the words given by Christ. He will remind you with the image of Christ. He will remind you with the mission in life. He will remind you with the goal of saving others. So, because the Holy Spirit inside your heart will not stay silent, will keep pushing you to have this mission in life, to offer your life as a sacrifice. And again, it was said like what? The Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. So if you feel like weak, the Holy Spirit will give you the strength, will empower you, will equip you to have this mission, to offer your life as a sacrifice. Help in our weakness, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. So, the S of sacrifice, see the other's needs, A, act always lovingly, C, care not for yourself. And the R, realign the values. I, imitate Christ. F, forget what's behind. I, involve others in your life. C, cut off your old nature. And the E, enjoy working with the Holy Spirit. Glory to God. Amen. If you have any comments or any questions, I'm so happy to have this number of people at 10 o'clock p.m. That's great. Let me ask a question. What do you know? Yes, go ahead, please.
How can you, is acting lovingly like a very big struggle?
No? Acting lovingly, what?
Is acting lovingly in the Christian life a struggle?
Yeah, you need to struggle to act lovingly. Because, you know, sometimes you think of yourself more. So you do not care for others what they need, what they want you to do. So you have to love. Love in the Bible, it's not about emotions. It's not romantic love. Love mentioned in the Bible, it's always about working in love, attitudes of love, actions of love. When you read the chapter of Corinthians, chapter 13, it's always related to actions. Love, you know, endures everything. Love cares. Love, not for, think of yourself. Go ahead, what's your question?
What if, like, you show the love to the person, but, like he doesn't take it as great as you think it?
Yeah, okay, so what? Because, you know, God Himself loved everyone in the world. And most of the world people do not care for His love. They do not respond back. They do not respect His love. They ignore His love. But He, being God is love, He continues loving them. So love never fails. Day after day, He wins many souls by His love. So you don't love people in order they should love you back. Sometimes they would not do this. But you are happy giving them. You are having this attitude of giving, forgiving, but you know you are not always waiting for them to love you back. Still not. I didn't get the question. Okay, thank you. Other questions, please, or comments? Go ahead.
How can I help the Holy Spirit to lead me?
How can I let the Holy Spirit to guide me, to lead me? That's a good question. Simply, when you pray from your heart, you are asking God to lead you, to guide you. So, first of all, we have to pray. Pray Psalms, pray Jesus Prayer, pray the Masses, Liturgy. Pray whatever you want to say to God. So when you spend more time with God, the Holy Spirit will, enlighten your mind, will tell you what exactly should you do. will purify your heart, so you will feel that you want to serve people more. So by praying, you are guided by the Spirit. But it's not, you know, that just the words of prayer. It's always related to the heart prayer. Other question? Go ahead. Okay. Thank you. I got it. Okay. In order to love your enemy, you know, it's one of the toughest commandments in the New Testament, because you cannot buy your heart as a human being to love somebody who hurts you or hurts your family. So you need the heart of God. You need the power of God. So I need to pray, asking God to help me. Help me to love this man. And by loving the enemy, it's not kind to be attracted to him. No, I cannot. That's not requested, you know. It just help to show Christian love, to make good deeds with this man, not to hurt him back. So it's all about actions. It's not about the heart, the emotions. And also, if you cannot do it by yourself, you need the power of God. So you need to pray for this. And also, in order to love your enemy, do not focus on what he had done. Focus on your mission. What should you do? And also remind yourself that the devil pushed him to do bad. So you hate the devil, but you don't hate him. Because this guy is, you know, was taken by the devil to do this bad thing. So if you focus on your mission, if you focus on Christ himself, if you pray strongly, you will feel the power to love your enemy. Go ahead.
So when you say love your enemy, do you mean you have to do something good, or is it enough to just do nothing bad?
No, it's not just the passive attitude of do not hurt him back. It's also pray for him, do good to him. I'll give you the words given by the Lord himself. So it's positive actions of serving him, not only stop, you know, the negative attitude towards him. This one, you know? When you read this, you know, love your enemies, as if he mentioned how to love your enemy. Bless those who curse you. So you speak good words. You don't, you know, curse them back. Do good. When you do good, that's an expression of loving your enemy. It's not, again, emotional love. It's positive, actual love. And also, pray for those. So, by praying, by doing good, by blessing them, that's kind of expressing this love for enemies. Go ahead.
What should we do if people use us?
What should we do if people
use us?
Okay. All commandments of the Lord should have also wisdom. You need to be wise in obeying the commandments. Without wisdom, the devil may use the commandment to hurt you back. So all commandments should be, you know, covered by the wisdom of God. So for those who are abusing us, I have to be wise, I should love them, but not on the expense that they hurt me spiritually. They may take my money, they may hurt me, you know, psychologically in a way, but I will not let them take me their side of being wicked or bad, because, you know, when you pray the first psalm, in the way of the wicked, you do not, you know, walk or stay or stand, because that's not loving enemies. They will hurt you spiritually. So when you have this wisdom of God, you can know what kind of space or distance you will have between yourself and this guy. You know the idea of boundaries or distances. In order to love anyone, you have to have kind of distance. You know, the joints, all joints of the human body have kind of what we call synovial fluid. In order this joint to move, there's just a drop of fluid between the two bones. Because when the bones move, it shouldn't, you know, make the friction. So this distance may be less than 1 millimeter in some joints, but it's very much important because it allows this smooth movement. So in order to love each other, we have to have some kind of distance, even between sisters and brothers, husband and wife, friends. We have to have some distance in order to move freely. So this distance is not the same between all relations. With bad guys, we have, you know, longer distance because we cannot come closer to them. But still, the attitude of loving them is there. Go ahead.
Do good to those who hate you. For example, I don't initiate doing good to someone that hates me. I will only do good if I'm in a situation to choose between good and bad, then I will choose the good. But I can't initiate something good towards someone who hates me.
No, sometimes you should initiate. He's asking about doing good to those who hate you. Should I proactively start this, or just if I'm in a situation to do good or bad, I choose to do good? Those ideas that are there. Because, you know, you will overcome their wickedness by your goodness. So when you show them love they do not expect, practical love, this will, you know, change their mind and their heart. Some of them will be affected up to, you know, you help them to be transformed into good people. Because the power of goodness is much stronger than the power of wickedness. Go ahead, Habib.
But we're supposed to love our enemies, but God gave us the power to tremble on the power of the enemy. So why would I still love my enemy if I...
Wait a minute, Habibi. The enemy here is not the enemy in the other verse. To triumph over the enemy, that's devil. I'm not asking you to love the devil. Hate him. But you know, to love your enemy, that's about people, human beings. So you are asked to love people, but you are not requested to love devil, shaitan. No. So you drive over devil, which is by praying, by the Bible verse, by sticking to the church, by focusing on repentance and confession. So you overcome all devilish actions. But with this, you know, you can love the enemies on the people's side. You got it? So the enemy in this verse is different from the enemy in the other verse. Go ahead. Yes. The Son of God was always there. She's asking in Arabic whether the Son of God, Christ, was there before incarnation? Yes. According to our faith, God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Trinity were there always, with no beginning and no end. That's one nature of God in three persons. And the three persons are divine persons. So the character of God is there in the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So Christ was always there. He is before anything. He had no beginning and had no end. But he came to our land. He was incarnate in time. He was born of Saint Mary 2,000 years. But in his divine nature, he was much before that time. So being God in his nature, he had no time, he had no beginning. But having this, you know, human nature, he should have a beginning like any of us. Go ahead, Paul.
How to
forget the past? Yeah. How can I forget the past? Okay, that's a good question. For those who suffered from many problems in their childhood, in their past, or they have done bad things and they always, you know, their mind is busy with these bad events happened. It's again, you need to pray more. Because with the power of prayer, this mindset will change. To focus on the future, not on the past. And when you are busy with God himself, and his plan for you, your mission, you know, you will pass over your pain and suffering. It's kind of struggle when you look back, you feel bad. But when you look forward, you feel better because you have a mission. So it takes some time to overcome this, you know. And also with the power of the Word of God, you know, when you read the Bible daily, regularly, and you are busy with some of the verses of the Bible, the power of the Word of God will help you to look, you know, forward, and it will help you to feel better as if you forget what happened before. Do you have any other question? Go ahead, Hamid.
How would I evade sin if it's all around me?
How what?
How would I evade sin if it's all around me?
Okay. First of all, you know, you have a power in your heart much stronger than the power of evil around you. Holy Spirit, God himself, is inside you. So it was written in the Bible that the one who is in you is much stronger than the one outside. الَّذِي فِيكُمْ أَعْظَمْ مِنَ الَّذِي فِي الْعَالَمِ. So God who is inside your heart is much greater than the devil power outside. And also all Christians should live as, you know, the life of difference. You have to be different. Being Christian, being the son of God, you shouldn't be like others. So everyone around may do sin, but you are not happy doing any sin because you are different. You were born to be a son of God, to have a mission in life. And when you study all the characters mentioned in the Bible, they were all different in their generations. Noah was different. All the people around him just ignored the message came from God, and they went with the flood. But Noah was different. Abraham was different. Moses was different. David was different. So these people, because they were the people of God, the men of God, they had a mission in life. That's why they kept the difference. But if you walk in this world to be like any other young man like you in this world, you lose your mission. You have no mission if you are exactly the same like anyone walking in this world. When you have a mission, you have to be different.
Can people complain about you being different?
Yes. Sometimes people will not be happy when they see you different. They may mock you, they may, you know, may not consider you as a friend because your values are not their values. Your mission are not their mission. Your goals are different. So you may lose many people because you are different. And that's exactly what the Lord said in his prayer. Read the study in John chapter 17. العالم أبغضهم لأنهم ليسوا من العالم. The world hated them because they are not of this world. So we expect to be hated from the world when you are very honest and all the community around you is happy lying, doing bad things, cheating. So they will hate you because you are fake, you are fake, you are honest. So sometimes you will have hard time because you are different. You have to expect this. You are a good girl and you don't like the idea of having a boyfriend and this. Many girls will look down to you as if you are retarded. Okay? So you will have some hard time because you are different. But because you have a mission in life and you look up to Christ, not up to the world, you will keep the difference and you are happy to be different. Why God made His way a narrow way or a narrow gate, and the way to heaven is full of troubles? You know, first of all, since Adam and Eve sinned, all human beings suffer. Even if you are not Christian, you're still living in this world, you will suffer. Because this world, this time, is for suffering. No one is happy living on earth. Because that was not the plan God planned for us. He planned for a happier life, a better life, which is now the eternal life. But also, if you imagine the way to heaven is very sweet, very pleasant, very comfortable, actually, we will never think of the heaven. Because we will, you know, stay here. We want to live here forever. Because here we are happy. But because we are not happy, we will think always of an afterlife in which we can rest, we can have this happiness. So having this narrow gate or troubled way, it pushes us to aim at the kingdom of heaven, to think of eternity. Another thing also, having this narrow gate, it that you choose to be Christ's girl. You choose to be, you know, a saint. So that's your choice. If it is an easy way, and if no one chooses anything, but having this narrow gate, it's always about your free choice. You prove your love to God by taking the cross, by accepting this hardship, this hard time, just because you love Him. Yeah. You know, let me tell you, Habaybi, because I have seen many people who suffered a lot from diseases, from persecution, from losses, even loss, losing many of their beloved. So I can tell you that trials, all hardships, all trials, كل التجارب, end up with at least four big important verses that are needed to catch the kingdom of heaven. First of all, you will learn how to pray in hard time. We all pray, but when it comes to hard time, we pray from our heart. We cry out to God. Because when we are stressed, we have no one to cry but God. Okay? So it's like a school for praying. The trial will teach me how to pray from my heart. The second important virtue, that no meaning for being patient with no hard time. When you have hard time, now you are having this virtue of patience or long suffering. So when you are suffering, you are now having this patience which is very needed, very much needed to catch the kingdom of heaven. It was given by the Lord, بِصَبْرِكُمْ تَقْتَلُونَ أَنفُسْكُمْ. By your patience or long suffering, you will gain your soul. The third virtue, when you pass through many hardships, you learn to be wise. For those who live an easy life, they are not wise. because they couldn't see the real life. When you visit the poor areas, when you visit the sick people, when you see the pains of the people, the refugee, those who came out of wars, you know, you can see the real picture of human beings. So wisdom is always the outcome of pain. That's the book of Job in the Old Testament, in the book of wisdom. Because Job, you know, had, you know, he suffered a lot. But because of his suffering and the friends who tried to help him, and their philosophy was not successful to please him. But with the end of the story, when you read this book, you will be wise. Because wisdom comes out of hardship. The last thing is humility. When people suffer, the pride, the you know, feeling glory, feeling superior, you know, it ends here. Because in the hard time, humility is born. You will be humble because when with suffering, you know how much little you are. And you need the power of God, and you cannot solve the problem by yourself. So people could see the truth, how much people are weak when it comes to hard times. So with the trials, now you gain power of prayer, patience, wisdom, and humility. So these are very precious. Any other comments or questions? Go ahead.
When you said in the hard times we learn not to pray, I believe that there are two types of people. In hard times they start praying more, and other people just don't feel like praying and they turn.
Okay, let me tell you, in most of the cases, because God wants everyone to come to Him, so even for those who reject God in times of trials, usually it takes some time, then they pray. So I had seen many people, when it comes to hard time, they, you know, blasphemed, they rejected God, they ignored faith, they went astray, and they think that there is no God, and if there is God, He is not wise, He is not love. But after some time, they couldn't do anything but praying. So with the wisdom of God, because He wants everyone to be saved, he made it with His wisdom in a way that with the end of the story, most of these people will be saved. But you know, again, it's the free will of man. Some people choose to stay against God, whatever it happens. And again, I'm telling you that all people, even not Christian, they also suffer, because all human beings are in suffering since Adam and Eve sinned. That's the picture of distorted human beings. The nature of man was distorted because of the sin.
But would it be a prayer from the heart?
Yes, usually. Usually it comes from the heart. Go ahead.
How to gain wisdom and how to gain humility?
Okay. First of all, how to gain wisdom. By the way, they usually come together, because it was written in the book of Proverbs, مَعَ الْمُتَوَاضَعِينَ حِكْمَةً. With the humble people, there is always wisdom. So they come together. In order to be wise, to get the wisdom of God, because there is another wisdom from science, from experiences, and some of this wisdom is not good, because some of the wisdom may be devilish. But the real wisdom of God, in order to gain, we need to pray, to ask for wisdom. That's exactly the words of James and James when he say that for anyone who lacks wisdom, just pray and ask God for wisdom. And we have this example of Solomon, the king, because he was young and he felt the responsibility, huge responsibility. So he spent the whole night crying out for wisdom, and he could see the Lord this night, and He gave him wisdom because he cried out for this. So when you feel like you need the wisdom, you have to pray. Another point, we have many books in the Bible, the books of wisdom. The life of the Lord Himself is full of wisdom. The words of the Bible, the New and Old Testament, full of wisdom. So when you study the Bible, you will be wise. Again, with the trials, as we were saying, with the hard time, you can see things differently. You will gain to be this wisdom through trials, through tribulations. When you serve people, when you serve the sick people and the poor people, when you visit the poor countries, you will gain wisdom. So, to gain wisdom is like a dynamic story. All our days, we are putting on and on more wisdom. In order to gain humility, first of all, we have to look up to the Lord, because He said it this way, تَعَلَّمُوا مِنِّي لَأَنِّي وَجِعُ مُتَعَضَ الْقَلِبِ. Learn after me, because I'm humble in heart, I'm meek, I'm hearted. So when you focus on Christ, when you imagine the Lord speaking to people, working this or that, you know, when you study the Gospels, the four Gospels, you can easily imagine the Lord in your place. What would He say? What would He do? So that's the first line. In order to be humble, you have to look up to Christ Himself. The second line, the forefathers said, in order to gain humility, you have to use three words. Shukran, thank you God, and thank you everyone. Sorry, which is repentance, and hadr, obedience. So by thanks, giving thanks, praising God continuously will fill your heart with humility. And with repentance, continuous repentance, you will be humble. And also when you obey, you put yourself in submission to the church, to the Father of Confession, to the whatever God allowed for you, you know, with this submission you will be humble. So by obedience, by praising God, by repentance, we can, you know, be more humble. Go ahead.
Is loving ourselves going to draw us away from God?
Loving ourselves will what?
Like, is it going to draw us away from God at some point?
Yeah, when we focus on ourselves, there is two ways to love ourselves. If you love yourself in a wise way, you will push yourself in the way of God. So that's a wise way, loving yourself. But if you love yourself just to please yourself, you don't want to push yourself in any way, you don't want to struggle to be good, now you are hurting yourself. So it depends upon the meaning of loving yourself. If you love yourself in the way God loves you, you are doing fine, because you will push yourself to be saint. But if you love yourself in a worldly meaning, like any girl in the world who loves herself, who loves her body, who loves to please herself, it will take you away from the way of God. Go ahead.
Can you give us an example where we can differentiate ambition from sacrifice, or how to include sacrifice when we're ambitious, whether it's in our professional career or in our academia?
Yeah. You know, sometimes ambition is like, you know, in a way, loving this world. Because sometimes ambition, you want to prove yourself to be rich, to be famous, people will look up to you. So it's all about yourself. And this way, it's not Christian. It's not the plan of God for you. But having the desire to be better and to achieve good things, it goes with the plan of God. Because God will make use of you to save many souls. So if you are very much successful in your career, this success will be used in a way to serve others, people. If you have many talents, you have to use these talents in serving God. So if your ambition is all about yourself,